Thank you for joining Wards of the Roses as we continue with part 3 on the Illuminati by Manly P. Hall. Taken from Horizon, Journal of the Philosophical Research Society, Spring 1947, Volume 6, Number 4. Professor Adam Weishaupt and the Bavarian Illuminati. Adam Weishaupt was one of the less known persons who received the impact of what may properly be defined as the intellectual revolution in Europe. It is important that we consider for a moment the tangle of circumstances which motivated his extraordinary career. This quiet little professor was destined to play a strange part in the political and social drama that eventually resulted in the overthrow of most of the monarchs of Europe and broke the temporal power of the church. The intellectual revolution was like a stream raised to torrential proportions by innumerable rivulets, hidden springs, and tributaries originating in distant mountains. The irresistible motion of art, literature, science, and philosophy, starting from Byzantium and flowering through Spain, Italy, and France, and finally reaching Central Europe, was called the Renaissance. It was the revival of civilization in Europe after those long, dismal centuries known as the Dark Ages. A parallel motion, with a somewhat more complicated background, led to a great schism within the religious life of Christian nations, generally termed the Protestant Reformation. It was inevitable that the Renaissance and the Reformation should bear fruit, each according to its kind. The first of this fruit was the impulse to liberty, the emancipation of the human mind from the limitations imposed by static institutions, which contested the inalienable right of the human being to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Natural sciences contested the solemn pronouncements of empiric scholasticism. Printing was invented. William Harvey discovered the circulation of blood. Copernicus defined the proportions of the solar system. Galileo overthrew the fallacy that the sun moved about the earth. Andreas Vesalius corrected the prevalent errors regarding the internal structure of the human body. Ambroise Pierre elevated surgery to a science and rescued it from barbers. Francis Bacon established the foundations of inductive reasoning. René Descartes turned men's minds to the analysis of themselves. And Sir Thomas More envisioned a utopian society for mankind. Each of these changes in attitude and viewpoint attacked long sequences of errors, and the total result was the loss of veneration for the sanctity of the status quo. In the years when newspapers were a single sheet, sometimes written by hand and copied by professional scribes, when there were no telegraph, telephone, or radio, very little travel, and no means of rapid transportation, it required centuries to circulate new ideas. The glad tidings of the rights of men were carried to distant places by dignified gentry riding on gaily caparisoned mules. A little later, the stagecoach took over, but still the process of indoctrination was slow. There were not only natural difficulties to overcome, but also artificial barriers of human prejudice and intolerance. Even after the seeds of freedom were sown throughout Europe, it required a long time for the harvest to be ready. Not until the second half of the 18th century did the new concept of life gain a following significant to bring about a radical change. Then suddenly, the slow-growing discontent burst forth in 1,000 places at once. This sudden manifestation of a conviction that had been gaining strength for ages brought about a violent revolt against authority. Under the leadership of such men as Rousseau and Voltaire, a school of thinking came into existence which questioned the infallibility of every man-made limitation imposed upon the universality of knowledge. The moving spirit of their philosophy was a sincere dedication to the basic premise that only education could release the human mind from bondage to ignorance, superstition, and fear. The whole school was dominated by an earnest humanism and unshakable conviction that man himself was important, and most of all, was important to himself. Adam Weishaupt responded to this challenge of this broad humanism, and he soon found that his students in canon law, fired with the natural ambition of youth, were also quick to respond to its stimulating cultural perspective. It was a day of new ideals, new courage, and new attitudes towards the known and the knowable. It became fashionable to think rather than merely to accept the thoughts of other men. The intellectual world suddenly discovered that it had a mind and that the power of the mind could be used to advance the cause of civilization. Adam Weishaupt was born at Ingolstadt on February the 6th, 1748, and died at Gotha in 1830. Surprisingly little is known of his parentage and his early life. He received his education in Jesuit schools, but while still a young man, he developed a sentiment of the utmost animosity against the order, a feeling which appears to have been mutual. In 1772, Weishaupt became a professor of law, and about the same time, he was expelled from the Jesuit college. 3 years later, he was appointed professor of natural and canon law in the University of Ingolstadt. He was the first secular professor to occupy this chair, which traditionally had belonged to an ecclesiastic. This circumstance in itself excited the anger of the clergy and widened the breach between Weishaupt and the social structure of his day. The little professor was an outspoken liberal and progressive, and quickly involved himself in a variety of difficulties. Even in this more enlightened century, a progressive professor in a large university might quickly lose his chair if he departed very far from the smug and conservative curriculum. Every school teacher knows that it is impossible to impart to his students the information which they most need to know, because to do so would be to come into open conflict with the formalized concepts of education. The teacher is paid to teach what he is told to teach. He is not paid to think. Dr. Weishaupt was a master over a classroom filled with the sons of well-to-do burghers and merchants, and the scions of wealthy aristocratic and noble families. The young men were keenly aware of the social motions of their time. Most young people are progressives until disillusioned. A revolution was pending in America, where taxation without representation had turned an enraged group of colonists against their motherland. There were rumblings of rebellion in France, whose citizens were organizing themselves for a struggle to the death against the tyranny and corruption of a decadent aristocracy. The young men in Weishaupt's class asked questions for which no satisfactory answers could be found in the approved texts of the university. The little professor answered these questions according to his own convictions, which appeared to have been somewhat to the left of dead center, which to his mind was dead indeed. As might be expected, the professor of canon law was called to account by the faculty for his radical pronouncements. And it may be assumed, without fear of exaggeration, that his enemies, political and clerical, made sure that his radical opinions were well publicized. The faculty handed down a simple edict. The language was classical, but the meaning was obvious. Shut up or get out. Weishaupt did the unexpected. He shut up, but his silence was more eloquent than his words. The members of his class fully realized that his silence was imposed by the Board of Regents, and the faculty lost caste with the student body. According to one account, the students demanded a continuation of the professor's liberal doctrines, but the discussions were moved from the classroom to apartments off the campus. The college itself was at a disadvantage. Many of Weishaupt's pupils came from influential families, and these pupils wanted Weishaupt and his message. The university could not afford to displease its noble and wealthy patrons, and was forced to overlook certain irregularities in the classroom on canon law. Backed, however, by a religious party, it set to work to destroy Weishaupt by organizing a secret machinery against him. It was this underhand method that brought matters finally to a head. Weishaupt decided that one must fight fire with fire. The entrenched conservatives of Europe were organized secretly to maintain status in quo. Liberals must also organize, and if necessary, with the same secrecy and with equal intensity of devotion and purpose. The little professor had undergone a long period of persecution. Naturally, the university wished to be regarded as progressive and was not of mind to expose its hand or reveal its league with the body politic and the body cleric. It followed a well-organized pattern. The Board of Regents had patted Weishaupt on the head with one hand and stabbed him in the back with the other. The church, already shivering in its robes at the prospects of the intellectual emancipation of its followers, was willing to go any length to prevent such a catastrophe. So Weishaupt was a victim of two groups of secret saboteurs, dedicated not only to the elimination of Weishaupt himself, but to the destruction of the whole humanist program, of which he was a humble representative. As there were secret forces at work in society to prevent the spread of intellectual liberty, why should the liberals remain unorganized? Why should they not band together as a group of intelligent and freedom-loving men, united in a fraternity which could work in secret? It was a splendid notion, considering the times and the circumstances. Unfortunately, Weishaupt, though apparently a well-informed man, had not the skill to work out all the details himself. Like most intellectuals, he had no clearly defined concept of practical ways and means, but he had infinite enthusiasm, and on May the 1st, 1776, he founded the Order of the Illuminati. At the very beginning of the enterprise, the professor was fortunate enough to gain the assistance of two important and influential gentlemen. The first was Baron Adolf von Nigg, a brilliant and amiable intellectual, a celebrated novelist, a lovable enthusiast, radiating gentility, a born diplomat and privy counselor of Saxe-Weimar. He had been initiated into the Masonic Order at Kassel in 1772 and received his Templar's degree a few years later. He was introduced to Illuminism by the Marcus Contenzo von Contenzo and entered heart and soul into the project. Nick's enthusiasm converted many outstanding Masons to the order. He took Weishaupt's basic material and elaborated the degrees and rituals of the society. It was the Baron von Nigg who converted Bode, the second of the two men immediately connected with the creation of the Illuminati ritualism. Jonah Joachim Christopher Bode was a man of the most upright character, of good social position, and a highly cultivated mind. He was an earnest seeker after spiritual truth and an uncompromising enemy of superstition and priestcraft. It was only after Nigg had convinced him that Illuminism was free from all taint of the church that he would connect himself with the society. Bode began life as a musician and later became a book dealer and translator. He translated the English writers Sterne, Burney, Montaigne, Fielding, Smollett, Goldsmith, etc. He was initiated into Masonry about 1753. He had an extensive knowledge of ancient religions and Masonic rituals, but his theories were regarded as vague by contemporary scholars. These three men, Weishaupt, von Nigg, and Bode, fashioned a secret society patterned after 100 already in existence, some of them dedicated to parallel purposes. The success of Freemasonry in surviving a variety of persecutions may have inspired the selection of a broad Masonic pattern, and the well-oiled Jesuit machinery offered advantages which also could be emulated. The primary purpose was simply to prop it by experience and to build a structure that could endure the constant and intense pressure of the church and state. Weishaupt was not a Freemason at the time he proclaimed the Illuminist Order, but a year later, in 1777, he was initiated into the Lodge Theodore of Good Counsel at Munich. After this new affiliation, he made every possible effort to incorporate Illuminism into the structure of Freemasonry. In this work, he was assisted by Baron von Nigg. The Freemasons, however, were having many troubles of their own and feared to incorporate so controversial a society into their own organization. There was considerable unofficial fraternization, and in most cases, Illuminist and Freemasonic lodges flourished in the same community the memberships overlapped. As early as 1782, Weishaupt and von Nigg developed a program for introducing Illuminism into France. Already several adepts of the cult existed in that country. The mayor of Strasbourg was one of them, and Mirabeau was another. He was initiated in Berlin, went on a secret mission for Louis XVI. When he returned to France, he initiated Charles Maurice de Talleyrand-Perigord. There is no doubt that the Illuminism spread considerably throughout the petty principalities of the German and Italian states and found some footing in the larger countries. The Illuminists originated in Bavaria, where the secret institution set up by the clergy had been officially abolished, but the church was still strong and was able to exercise a wide influence in the politics of the country. The pressure groups, as we will call them today, set industriously to work to destroy Illuminism root and branch. First of all, the Illuminists were branded as anarchists. Their doctrines were distorted and documents were forged to create the impression that they were attacking all constituted authority. By this procedure, the members were made to appear criminals and outcasts so that they could be imprisoned for years without trial. The church fell back upon its favorite theme, heresy, and improvised upon the theme with a number of ingenious variations. The Illuminists were obviously pagan because they opposed the clergy, a hideous crime which no good Christian would condone. The order was therefore pronounced anathema. The Illuminists were evidently in league with the devil, another well-known artifice. Investigation indicates that nearly all human progress can be traced directly to His Infernal Majesty. Any mind which dared to oppose prevailing prejudices or had the courage to explore into the mysteries of nature was obviously in league with the powers of evil. The Illuminists were accused, like the Templars before them, of indulging in bacchanalian orgies, nocturnal sabbats, and a score of other obscene sorcery. It was therefore the solemn duty of a vigilant church, ever mindful of the need of her children and ever striving to preserve the human soul from contamination, to rise in all its venerable and virtuous might to eliminate those heretics from the face of the earth, or at least from Bavaria. The touching solicitude of both the church and state in this respect is typical of the loving care with which sacred and profane aristocracy sought to preserve the ignorance of the common man, but all their effort was in vain. Humanism was an irresistible force. Persecution only strengthened its purpose and bound its leaders into a stronger fraternity of objectives. The doom of dogma had been sounded. Light was breaking through in so many places and in so many ways that even the strongest weapons of the incumbent power were useless to prevent the motions of destiny. It has been said that the French Revolution was directly traceable to the rise of humanism in Europe. The revolutionists cast off church and state and set up the Temple of Reason in the sanctified shrine of Notre Dame. The revolution was not solutional, but it was inevitable. The government passed into the hands of the mob, and for a time, the pressure of ages blazed forth in uncontrollable fury. Men who never known liberty had no way of administering its power. The good was swept away with the bad. Culture and decadence perished together. The arts, the sciences, and the philosophies were leveled at the guillotine. The beggar was on horseback. It was his first ride, and he rode himself to death. The method used for breaking up the Bavarian Illuminists was simple and traditional. Two or three members of the outraged clergy obtained membership in the society by misrepresentation. After perjuring themselves and apparently subscribing wholeheartedly to the Illuminist program, they turned traitors, exposing as much of the work as they knew and misrepresenting the entire enterprise. Four professors of the Marian Academy also joined them and withdrew, admitting that they had not advanced beyond the first degrees. These malcontents issued statements to the effect that the Illuminists condemned all religion, country, and property, and that during the lodge sessions, speeches were delivered advocating liberty and equality as the inalienable rights of mankind. The elector of Bavaria, unable to estimate the extent of the societies, decided to meet the situation by general edict against all secret associations within his domain. The elector was motivated by a variety of considerations. First and most important was the tide of revolutionary organization rising across the border in France. Then Strouvel, a rejected candidate, printed a pamphlet in 1783 denouncing the Illuminist order and accusing it of subversive activities. About the same time, a Masonic lodge, the Lodge of the Three Globes, issued a secular, warning Masons against the Illuminists. This resulted in several influential members withdrawing from the Weishaupt group. The Freemasons realized that the Illuminists were receiving more publicity than was healthy at the moment. On June the 22nd, 1784, the blow fell in the form of an electoral edict suppressing both the Illuminist and Freemasonry throughout Bavaria. Both groups obeyed the law immediately and offered to produce all their papers as proof of their innocence of political intrigue. The courts, however, were in the hands of their enemies, and they were not permitted to clear themselves. A second edict followed on March the 2nd, 1785. The reason for this edict is not clear, as it is an historical fact that both societies had disbanded in obedience to the first proclamation. The second edict was followed by an era of persecution. The accused were denied the privilege of trial, with the exception of a few of high birth or position. Many languished in prison for years. Among the punishments, it was noted that Marcus of Costanza and another Italian, Count Saviola, were banished with pensions of 800 florins. Canon Hertel was deprived of his benefits. Baron Machenhoff suffered a month of imprisonment in a monastery, and Weishaupt was deprived of his professorship and banished from the country. He repaired to Gotha, where he was kindly received by Duke Ernest, who made him counselor and gave him a pension for life. While at Gotha, Weishaupt wrote and published many books on philosophic subjects and in defense of Illuminism. Among these were A Picture of the Illuminati, 1786, A Complete History of the Persecutions of the Illuminati in Bavaria, 1786. First half only was published. An Apology for the Illuminati, 1786. An Improved System of the Illuminati, 1776. A typical example of the methods used in stamping out Illuminism in Bavaria can be gathered from the misfortunes of the Bavarian advocate Franz Xaver von Zweck. In 1786, the House of von Zweck was broken into and searched without a warrant, and a number of original papers and correspondence confiscated. The papers included such choice items as the following: a description of a strong box, which if forced open would blow up and destroy its contents; a recipe for invisible ink; a means for taking impressions from seals; and a collection of the same; a set of portraits of 85 distinguished ladies of Munich, with recommendations of some of them as members of a lodge of sister Illuminati; a recommendation that all superiors learn to write with both hands; and some data about ciphers. Von Zweig, who was a judge, published a letter denying all charges, declaring that the documents were extracts from celebrated writings useful to him in the practice of law. The portraits of the 85 ladies were stolen by the police from the private wardrobe of Franz von Zweig. Under the conditions, however, it seemed advisable to leave the country, and von Zweig went into service of the Prince of Psalms, who shortly afterwards was a ringleader in political disturbances in Holland. The physical history of the Bavarian Illuminati extended in all over a period of 12 years. It is difficult to understand, therefore, the profound stir which this movement caused in the political life of Europe. We are forced to the realization that this Bavarian group was only one fragment of a large and composite design. Each of its members became a champion of human rights, and although its memberships were scattered about Europe, the spirit of the organization exercised an influence far greater than its numerical strength would seem to justify. Thank you for watching. Please don't forget to like, share, subscribe, and comment. And if you can, please consider donating to Wars of the Roses. Links to PayPal and Patreon are in the description. Thank you very much.